Coming up, taking a scenic flight above Cape Cod with airshow performer Michael Gouley.
Plus, these bonanzas fuel an international friendship and a journey across the globe.
And building the future, we work to inspire the next generation of aviators. AOPA Live this week begins in just a moment.
This is AOPA Live this week with Tom Haynes and Alyssa Cobb.
It's the very future of aviation, and AOPA's You Can Fly program is lighting the path. The high school STEM aviation curriculum is in hundreds of schools, and that number is growing.
AOPA Live's Paul Harrop checks in on the program and shows you how members can help it grow.
The high school program is essentially a four-year high school sequence of courses.
And it continues to develop.
We started 6 years ago, and each year we've added a new course to the curriculum. So we are now up to this upcoming year. We will have five of our six courses available. They are in two pathways, pilot pathway and drone pathway. There are schools can offer any one, some, or all the courses. We are currently in 200 schools, 36 states, 8,000 students, hoping to grow that dramatically in the upcoming year.
Things are looking up. While women and people of color may be drastically underrepresented in aviation as compared to the population as a whole, the opposite is true for the STEM curriculum. Enrollment reflects the communities and the United States more accurately.
As we get into these communities that are more diverse, we're seeing a more diverse group of students that come through the program. So, but the point being is that we see this growth across the United States, but we're beginning to get that recognition that there's something really special about this program, and people are beginning to reach out to us, and it's an exciting time to be part of the program.
And a lot of that momentum comes from the influence of AOPA members in their respective communities.
They're members of the community, right? They're involved in their community. They may be elected officials. They may have some sort of influence. They go out and they have conversations with people and say, hey, there's this really cool program out there. Here's the website. And just something as simple as an awareness, the idea of building awareness in school districts that this is available, is incredibly helpful. It gives school districts that first sort of impetus to say, wow, there may be something of value here. And then the school districts end up reaching out to us, and we've seen a lot of success with that.
And that success will continue to foster the future success of students reached by the AOPA curriculum. Paul Harrop, AOPA Live.
Now, if you'd like to learn more about the program, or if you want to help, learn more about our website. If your school wants to enroll in the program, the deadline for the next school year is coming up. It's May 31st. So now is the time to reach out and start the process. Now, how to get more people of all ages and backgrounds involved in aviation was a major focus of audience questions Tuesday night during our live virtual AOPA General Aviation Town Hall. Corporate pilot Kim Kish asked Mark Baker what AOPA was doing to get more women into general aviation.
It is one of the things that I believe wholeheartedly in as a father of three daughters and a grandfather of four granddaughters. I think there's no barriers to aviation for gender, and there shouldn't be. One of our successes that we've early started on is the You Can Fly program, where we started teaching in high school in the ninth grade a number of years ago now. And this year, finally coming up with the fourth year, the 12th grade curriculum. We have about 25, a little north of 25% of those young women taking that class. Out of all those 8 or 9,000 kids, 25% of them are young women taking this class, and about 40% are of minority represented groups.
Aaron Reeves wanted to know how pilots can inspire non-aviators to join the community without scaring them with excessive negativity about regulations and other issues.
You know, for years, I think we hurt ourselves in aviation by talking about the $100 hamburger and there I was and this happened. And coming off of World War II, I knew a lot of those World War II pilots in the 70s. You know, that swashbuckle side of aviation has always been part of the early days. But I think one of the things that we have to remind people why we got into aviation in that conversation first, because it's fun. And because we have a freedom to fly that doesn't exist practically anywhere else in the world. And start with the reasons why we did it, and then encouragement to say, and you can do it too. one of the things we haven't done a very good job in aviation, and I think we frankly have gone backwards a bunch since 9/11, where we put fences around the airport to say no trespassing, you know, pilots only, owners only. That's wrong. These are public parks. These are parks that the taxpayer paid for that create access from either business activity or recreational activity that we have just really alienated the neighborhood, sometimes the public, about. So we, as responsible aviators, have to invite people back out there. And there's always going to be the grumpy one. I can't tell you how to handle all the grumpy ones. There are not that many of them. But there are the few and the loud from time to time. But aviation is a great thing. I would say one of my favorite things about aviation is going to the airport, seeing people having fun, playing, and see how much excitement there is, and frankly, taking people for a ride of all ages, that there is nothing that equals the excitement of leaving gravity and the Earth, taking a tour around where you live or where you go, and feeling that freedom, the air. I'm telling you, there isn't anything else like it. And I think we have to do a better job to invite, to welcome, and to accept everybody that wants to be around that airport and those airplanes.
Now you can find the full video on the AOPA Live YouTube channel.
You need to find a solution to intentional GPS interference. That's what AOPA and NBAA said in a letter to the military and Department of Transportation. The military is still routinely holding intentional GPS jamming events. They do it so they can train for the loss of GPS in combat. The problem is, with the growing reliance on GPS, jamming is continuing to create headaches for GA and many other business sectors. AOPA and NBAA recognize the need for military training, but it's taking too long to find solutions to minimize the impact. It's been 3 years since a federal advisory committee gave over 24 suggested solutions to the issue, and we haven't heard much since then. The letter asks for a status update. You can read more about it on our website.
And the FAA says laser strikes are continuing to pose a threat to pilots. Over 6,800 laser strikes reported last year. That's the highest number since 2016. The FAA released this video to raise awareness. And they want the public to know it's not a joke. A laser can completely incapacitate a pilot. It's also a federal crime that carries hefty fines.
Now, losing an engine is a scary situation no matter what, but with loved ones on board, the situation is amplified. On the latest Air Safety Institute There I Was podcast, GA pilot Kelly Keller tells the story about losing an engine in Arkansas while 7 months pregnant with her husband on board.
So smoke pretty much immediately filled the cockpit. And, you know, when that happens, you always think through what that might look like and just, you know, in our training, figure out what your action plan is. But until that happens to you, it's really startling. Startling. So, you know, the first thing I did was just kind of start troubleshooting. Okay, is it electrical? Is there clearly a fire? No. So I opened up the windows just to try to get some air, kill the cabin heat, which was a kind of a crucial component when it came down to it. Because once I killed the cabin heat, the smoke stopped. So I was like, okay, you know, it smelled oily. I could kind of tell it was something like that. And at that point, I looked over at my oil pressure gauge, and it was at zero.
Hear the rest of the story on the Air Safety Institute website.
As it starts to get warmer across much of the country, thank goodness, it's time to think about planning that summer vacation. Cape Cod, off the coast of Massachusetts, has a lot to offer as a flying destination. AOPA Pilot Senior Features Editor Julie Walker wrote a story about Cape Cod for our Destinations issue. And she asked Massachusetts pilot and airshow performer Mike Ragulian to share his experiences flying around the Cape.
Even though I've flown all these years for work, when you do a flight like we did that night with the sun setting, and, you know, my daughter and my wife in the plane, and it was such a beautiful night that you appreciate what general aviation gives to you and what flying means to me now, even 30 years later, it's so special. The Cape is pretty amazing because the geography really changes. You go on the Cape Cod Bayside, there's beautiful cliffs, and then you get down past Hyannis, and then it becomes very, if you will, sort of marshy and sand dunes, and then you come up to Provincetown, and you see all kinds of different landscapes in a very short period of time. You could fly, a lot of people fly down, you know, 500 feet along the beach, and there's whale watching boats. There's a ton of seals. So you'll be able to see all kinds of mammals in the water, and just being able to enjoy all of that. I'm a lobster eater through and through. My dad, when I was a kid growing up, in the summertime, we'd go on vacation, and my dad could like completely annihilate each twin boiled lobsters and all the steamers that we could eat. And that hasn't changed. If you're interested in beaches, then Cape Cod is the place to go, especially if you want to fly there. You can go right to Provincetown and basically walk to the beach, and flying there is the best way because you beat all the traffic. You know, one of the things I would tell pilots that are going to come to the Cape and the islands in the summertime is that it's busy and there's a big mix of traffic. You just want to sort of be on your game, be vigilant, but it's really a beautiful part of the country, and there's so much to see just within a small area, and airplanes are the way to get there.
Be sure to check for any COVID-19 travel-related restrictions before you plan a trip. Well, Michael Goulian is also a longtime friend of AOPA. He's a You Can Fly champion, and he was just named chairman of the AOPA Foundation's Hat in the Ring Society. The society is a way for you to support the future of general aviation each year with a charitable donation between $1,000 and $10,000. Now, the AOPA Foundation supports crucial initiatives such as our You Can Fly program and the AOPA Air Safety Institute. I'll find out more about the Hat in the Ring at AOPA Foundation's website.
Coming up after the break, Textron is killing some iconic models. Find out which ones.
And GA draws two unlikely friends together. We'll be right back.
The future of USB charging power has arrived. Introducing new ultra-fast charging TA360 USB chargers. Unlock the power of USB Power Delivery, PD, technology. Max power. Multiple configurations. In-seat, cabin, cockpit, and galley USB power. Easy to install. Backed by the best. True Blue Power, the USB experts.
Welcome back. Textron announced this week that it'll stop production on two aircraft. The Beechcraft King Air C90 GTX twin-engine turboprop will no longer be rolling off the assembly line there in Wichita. The 90 series was the first of the King Air line and is the smallest of the King Airs. It was a derivative of the piston-engine Queen Air. Also retreating to the history books, the Cessna Sovereign midsize business jet. Demand for both aircraft has declined in recent years.
While Texan is reducing its lineup, Bi Aerospace is making progress on its all-new electric eFlyer 2 trainer. The airplane will have a whole aircraft parachute system made by Aviation Safety Resources. The company just tested that parachute system using barrels of water to replicate the weight of the aircraft. Now, the fuselage is also under construction for serial number 1. Bi is also working on a 4-seat eFlyer 4 and hinted at a potential 8-seat electric twin. Wow. Now, the company says they have over 700 orders for their electric aircraft. And more news from the electric flight world. Rolls-Royce says its electric system will power the Vertical Aerospace flagship urban air mobility aircraft. Rolls-Royce will design the entire propulsion system. Now, Rolls also announced a partnership with Technam for the P-Volt, an all-electric twin-motor aircraft.
And hey, while we're talking about electricity, Boca Raton Airport in Florida says it'll be the first airport in the nation to install a newly approved LED rotating beacon. The LED beacon has a higher light output, but uses much less electricity than the traditional beacons you see at most airports. Also creates less light pollution across airport neighborhoods because the light beam is confined to the area above the airport rather than washing across the ground. It will also cost much less to maintain.
Women in Aviation International is offering a new series of scholarships thanks to the Conrad Hilton Foundation. The foundation is offering $250,000 for 47 new scholarships. Now, the scholarships are for training in a variety of aviation careers, from air traffic control to space. Now, you need to be a Women in Aviation International member to apply. You can find out more at the WAI website.
General Aviation brings the world together. It doesn't just bring people physically closer. The GA community unites people from all different backgrounds and walks of life. AOPA Editor-at-Large Dave Hirschman brings us the story about how two pilots from different parts of the globe became friends.
This is my friend Shinji. He's going to fly around the world. I don't know why anybody would want to do that. Shinji, why would you want to do that?
Because I'm crazy, I guess.
This is an unlikely friendship. Adrian Eichhorn and Shinji Maeda are 24 years apart in age, and they were born on different continents in different cultures. But the two long-distance flyers, both of whom fly Beach Bonanzas, built in the early 1960s, discovered they have more than their V-tailed airplanes in common.
Yeah, we have become really good friends because we've noticed that very similar things happened in our lives with losing our fathers, both having motorcycle accidents, and we joke that our first flight was over a car and we hit the pavement, and here we now are brought together later on in life and share the same freedom of aviation and passion.
Adrian, a recently retired airline pilot, flew his Bonanza around the world in 2016. Shinji is about to begin a similar globe-spanning journey, and Adrian is helping him plan the flight.
I learned early on that Shinji was unique and that he was serious. And I thought, if he's serious about it, I will go to the end of the earth to help him out.
At the start of their trip, the two plan to fly their airplanes together across most of the Atlantic Ocean starting in May.
I'll be flying with three other Bonanzas, and Shinji will be leaving from here at Frederick, going up to Bangor, St. John's, Newfoundland, to Iceland, and over up to Norway, Spitsbergen, Norway, over the pole to Fairbanks, Alaska. And Shinji will fly with us, and once we get to Iceland, he'll depart to the UK and we'll go over the North Pole.
Shinji will continue eastbound all the way around the Northern Hemisphere, sharing his story along the way. He's blind in one eye as a result of his motorcycle accident and overcame many challenges to become a pilot. He recognizes that everyone, everywhere, faces adversity, and he hopes to encourage them through his own personal example.
The purpose of this mission flight is provide hope and dreams. I didn't expect any accident. However, things happen, and things change your life. However, as long as you have a positive attitude to move forward, guess what? You can make it happen, a lot of things. And this is not only about aviation. This is all about how you're going to live your life. That's the message we do.
Dave Hirschman, AOPA Live.
You can read more about these Global Bonanza pilots in the April issue of AOPA Pilot Magazine. So, Alyssa, it's great to see those two pilots together. They're good friends, and Adrian talks a lot about the Fellowship of Aviators and helping pilots, and he's done a lot to help pilots around the world, and I know he's been on the receiving end of a lot of help from other pilots, too.
Yeah, it is amazing how it brings people together around the world, and seeing them them working together is wonderful.
Yeah, it really is. It's a great story in the magazine, too. Well, that's it for our show this week. Thanks for watching.
And if you catch us on YouTube, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And you can also let us know your thoughts about the show on the email address on your screen.
See you back here next Thursday.
My name is Terry Carbonell. I live in the Florida Keys on a private airstrip called Tavernero. What I fly is a 182RG. Wild Mama is her name, 614 Whiskey Mike. You know, SiriusXM is just the best product out there. I fly in the mountains a lot, and ADS-B is a line of sight. You can't get ADS-B, you have big gaps in the mountains, and that's, gosh, when would you want to have good weather is in the mountains. I like to fly low. I've flown across the United States at 1,000 feet AGL because it's all about scenery. You can't always get ADS-B when you're at 1,000 feet, but I always have SiriusXM weather and radio. SiriusXM radio is on 24/7 when I'm in the plane. SiriusXM weather just keeps you out of trouble. It's certainly avoiding bad memories. It's nothing like having reliable weather service in the cockpit.